In Sunshine, we'll be using content providers to help us efficiently sync data from the internet. Combined with the utilities in the Android framework, it also simplifies getting database content to and from our user interface. We implement a content provider by extending the content provider class. In Sunshine, we'll call this class Weather Provider. We'll use the Weather Provider to read and write the database we just created. You're probably excited to get started on building our Weather Provider, but if you're still unsure about what content providers are and how they work, we've built a great exercise that demonstrates how to take advantage of all this gnarlicious goodness. Why gnarlicious? Because this exercise leverages the user dictionary provider. So, if you ever wanted to make your radicalocious vocabulariousness better understood by your mobile friend Panion while learning more about content providers, check the instructor notes below for a link to the bonus lesson. Building a content provider involves several steps: determining the URIs your application will need to support, updating the contract to include these URIs, filling out a URI matcher that supports each of these URIs, and implementing the 6 required content provider functions. Okay, the task is determining URIs, but what's a URI anyhow? A content provider allows us to think of the data associated with our views in terms of universal resource identifiers, or URIs. URIs do exactly what their name implies. They identify a resource, in our case, a row or rows in a database. You're almost certainly familiar with the concept of a URI, since the URL used for every web address is actually a type of URI. In the case of the web, it's a URI used to identify web content with an HTTP or HTTPS scheme. In this example, Sunshine is using a URI to query the weather for the 94043 location. Our content provider returns a cursor containing the database rows that correspond to the URI. By changing the query value of the URI, we can have Sunshine display weather from different parts of the country. Each URI can contain the content scheme. A scheme is the first part of a URI that precedes the colon, and it identifies the protocol that the URI will be using. You are used to seeing schemes such as HTTP and FTP in URIs. Content colon implies that the URI refers to a content provider. A content authority, which is a unique string used to locate your content provider, and it should almost always be the package name of the application. A location, which typically points to a database table within the application. An optional query. This query can either be part of the URI path, or it can take the form of a traditional URI query following a question mark. As it turns out, a URI is the primary piece of data that is passed in these intents that Rato so gloriously described. In Sunshine, we'll leverage this to start the detail view with a URI that points to the weather on a specific day. The detail view uses this URI to query weather provider and get the right weather data to display. Another thing that these content provider URIs is used for in Android is to notify the user interface that a piece of the data it is displaying has changed. The code registers an Android construct called a content observer during our initial query against the URI that is being displayed. When running a database update routine, likely on another thread, that routine will tell Android that the data associated with the URI has changed, and ultimately that the URI should re-query the database and refresh the display. This will cause the display to refresh and show the latest data, even though, as you can see here, the URI hasn't changed. Content providers can return all sorts of data, but the abstract functions return either a cursor containing a list of items or a single item. How these URIs are structured is up to each application, but Android provides support for appending an ID to the URI path to indicate that the application is interested in a specific record rather than a range of records. In Sunshine, the value for a specific date and time is appended to the query for weather at a specific location, and that causes a single weather record to be returned. So, defining URIs. To make it easy for us, I've defined these data URIs that we will be supporting. Some of these URIs exist because the UI has a view that needs to expose that particular data, such as weather with location, which will be used to display the main list of forecasts. And, of course, weather with location and date, which will be used to display the detailed forecast information. Others are used primarily for writing the database: inserts, updates, and deletes. Having these base URIs is also useful for testing. Now it's time to go back to our weather contract. When we first described what a weather contract is, We said that it is an agreement between the data models, storage, and views, presentation, describing how information is accessed. It turns out that in addition to the column names for our database, the contract is also a great place to define the URIs that our application will be using to access its data. Next, we'll explain what you need to add to your weather contract. When you've completed adding this code to your project, I'll explain a bit about what you've done.